As solar power has become a lot more powerful and easier for the average person to access, its use cases have become a lot more widespread. We're seeing bigger systems for whole home use or off-grid living, medium-sized systems for emergency backup or peak shaving, and smaller systems which would be good for like an RV, a garage, a shed, or some kind of project use. But this means that there are more products than ever to choose from, and with so many options, if you're new to this, it's almost a guarantee that this is gonna seem overwhelming. How do you choose the components that are best for you? What are watts and amps and how many do you need? And how do you make sure your system fits together and works properly? Honestly, it's a lot easier than some other people might be making it seem. So hopefully today we're going to be able to help you guys make some decisions. So welcome back to the lab where our opinions cannot be bought. Before you go ahead and actually select or purchase a kit, there's 5 key things that you need to ask yourself to make sure that you actually end up getting the right products for your needs. Before we jump into what those 5 things are, we're gonna hit you guys with one of our classic 60-second electricity lessons to make sure everyone is on the same page and you fully understand everything that we're gonna be talking about in today's video. Electricity is actually very easy to understand, and the only thing that we really need to know today for this video is watts. If you picture a garden hose, like a faucet on the outside of your wall that you open and close, when you open, it allows a certain amount of pressure to flow out and through the opening. That's volts. Volts is something you don't really have to worry about because it's pretty standardized. A house has 120 or 240 volts. So volts, not super important. Amps is like the hose coming off. The more amps, the thicker the hose is. So if you have a 15 amp hose, it'll be this big and it's gonna allow the 120 volts to go through at 15 amps. A 20 amp hose is gonna be a little bit bigger and allow that to flow through much more efficiently. The water flying out the end is watts. If you were to put that into a bucket, the bigger your hose and the more your faucets opened, the more water is going to end up in that bucket within an hour. And that's watts. And watts is a timely measurement. If you have a 100-watt light bulb, that means it's going to take 100 watts per hour. If you only use it for half an hour, it's only going to take 50 watts that hour. And the reason you need to know this is because everybody's equipment and things that they're trying to power is a little bit different. So you can't just Google like, how much power does my light take? Most fixtures will tell you the volts and the amps. If you multiply volts and amps, you get watts. So if you're gonna power a 100 watt light bulb and you get a 1000 watt battery bank, you can power that light bulb for 10 hours. And in that example, if your inverter is only 50 watts, which all inverters are way bigger than the inverters grow as the batteries grow, you probably won't run into this problem. But if that inverter was only 50 watts, it wouldn't be able to power the light bulb. It needs to be at least a 100 watt inverter. So now that we're all speaking the same language, the first step is to determine what you're going to be powering and for how long. The goal here is to get a battery bank size. This is actually really simple to do, but a lot of people assume their power needs and then they end up getting a system that's way underpowered for what they actually need. We're gonna use Josh's tiny cabin as our example. There's a little bit of light math required here. There's no way around it, but let's get into it. So Josh Airbnbs his tiny cabin. Inside of that cabin, he needs to power simple things like lights, which are about 20 watts, his mini fridge, which is about 50 watts, a UV bulb, which is about 100 watts, and some kitchen appliances. He has a TV in there, light stuff. The goal here is to find out how much power you're gonna be using every day. And so to do this, we're just gonna be taking the wattage from each device, multiplying it by the amount of hours you plan to use it each day, and that'll get us our average daily usage. We tend to recommend using the largest numbers possible for this math. So if he's gonna be Airbnb in this cabin throughout the winter, obviously in the middle of winter, they're gonna be using way more lights, way more power for heat, stuff like that. I would go with those numbers, make sure that you have enough. In the middle of winter, his guests use roughly 10 hours of lights. The UV bulb for the water treatment is on 24 hours. There's no way around it. The fridge is also on 24 hours. Although fridges don't run their rated output all the time, they run about 15 to 20% of their rated output per hour. We have an entire video showing how fridges actually work. They use a lot less power than a lot of people tend to say they do. Anyways, we're gonna go with the high end number here and say that it uses 20% of its rated power every hour, roughly 3 hours on the TV, and do this kind of practice with everything inside of the cabin, add it all up, and try to get a number of how much power roughly gets used every 24 hour period. If you're having any trouble with this, we'll leave a link to a calculator in the description down below. But regardless, when you're doing this, we recommend rounding up on any numbers that you can and giving yourself a little bit of extra leeway just in case. If you're trying to do these numbers for your entire house, I would just say go get your electricity bill. Most electricity bills show you your daily, weekly, and monthly usage. So it's all laid out for you right there. In our example, we determined that Josh uses roughly 5,000 watts per day at the tiny cabin. And so that's the daily usage. In our case, 5,000 watts. The next part is to determine runway. For this example, Josh has his limit at Airbnb set to about 3 days. So no one can actually stay at the cabin longer than 3 days. So he knows he only needs that 5,000 watts per day for a maximum of a 3 day period. So in his case, he takes the 5,000 watts he needs per day, multiplies it by three, which lands him at about a 15 kilowatt hour battery bank. For you guys, it may be you want to use the amount of time that you experience a blackout during a natural disaster, like a hurricane, or maybe you live somewhere that's really sunny and you're just trying to plan for like the 3 to 4 days in a week where you might not have sun and you just want to get through that longest gap. Whatever it is, the amount of time that you're gonna go without power is your multiplier. You take your daily power and multiply it by the amount of days that you don't think you're gonna have sun generating you new power. Make sure you write down these numbers. We are gonna need them again in 1 minute. Step two is gonna be, how do you plan on getting power into your system? The two main options here are solar or not solar, which would be the grid or a generator. We're gonna start with solar. If you plan on going solar, you need to figure out your array size, and there is three main steps to this. First thing you need to do is determine your daily peak sun hours. Peak sun hours are when the sun is nice and high in the sky and actually hitting your panels at the right angle. In the morning and at night, the sun's obviously much lower. You're not generating full power out of your panels. Most places in the US have an average of 3 to 5 peak sun hours per day. You can find this number really quickly with a quick Google search. The next step here is to determine your wattage. So you're gonna take your battery bank size that you already determined. In our example, it was 15 kilowatt hours, and you're gonna divide that by your peak sun hours. So in our case, it's gonna be 15 kilowatts divided by 4. We actually get 5 peak sun hours where we live, but we're trying to be safe and make sure that we have a powerful system. So we're gonna use 4 hours. And that actually gets us like 3.75. We're gonna round up and call it 4,000 watts. This means that our 4 kilowatt solar array would be able to power all of our batteries within 1 day of good sunshine. We always recommend you try to get it full within 1 day, just because you can never predict the weather. Josh's example, if he just got one good day of sun, he could charge up enough for 3 days of runway. The faster you can fill those batteries, the more luck you're gonna have just not running out of power. And the last part is figuring out your array size. So now that you know you need a 4,000 watt solar array, panels come in all kinds of shapes and sizes. You gotta figure out what works best for your house. Maybe you only have room for 100 watt panels, or you have room for 400 watt panels. Whatever it is, pick the panels that will work for you. If we were gonna choose 400 watt panels, we would just divide the 4,000 watts by 400. That gets us 10 panels. And we know that with 10 400 watt solar panels, we will easily hit our 4,000 watt solar array. If you're not planning on using solar and you're planning on using the grid or a generator, you don't even have to worry about this step. Just hang in there and we will get to this later on. Step three is determining how much are you gonna be powering at one time and what kind of power do you need, 120 or 240 volts. The goal here is to determine what inverter works for your system. And to do this, it's really easy. In the first step, you added up all the appliances that you know that you're gonna use. In this step, you're gonna add the wattage for everything that you plan to power all at one time. Don't cheese out on yourself here. You don't wanna be running around from room to room, turning off a light so that you can turn on the vacuum. Make sure that you account for everything that could be on all at once. In Josh's example, we went to his cabin, flicked on everything. It surged at around 2000 watts, and then it ran at around 1200 watts steady. So he needed about a 2000 watt total output. And since all of his appliances only run off 120 volts, he only needed an inverter that can do 120 volts. And so now he has the three main important pieces of information. The first one, he needs an inverter that can run 2000 watts continuous. It needs to be able to run 120 volts 240 would obviously be a bonus so he could upgrade in the future. And it needs to have at least a 4,000 watt solar input. And so now there's only one key decision left for him to make. Step four is determining what type of system suits your needs. This is a very simple step, but it's mandatory. And no matter what you pick in 2025, we recommend going with an all-in-one inverter. This just means that your inverter includes all the separate parts like the breakers, the solar charge controller, the less accessories that you need to mount outside of your inverter, the more that they're all housed within your inverter, the better. Most of them also allow you to program it for time of use settings, so you can tell it when to charge, when to discharge, based on input power, states of battery, solar conditions, things like that. In Josh's case, the cabin is completely off-grid. There is no grid power available, so he needs an off-grid inverter. This EG4 3000 would actually be a perfect solution to Josh's needs. It has a 3000 watt output, so a little bit of buffer for what he uses. It does 120 volts. It has a 5000 watt solar input, so a little bit of buffer for what he needed. And it's a really cheap, affordable, and well-reviewed off-grid inverter. Something important to know is most, if not all, off-grid inverters by this point have an AC in That doesn't mean that they tie into the grid, but what it does mean is that you could, for example, when we do testing, we take an extension cord, we plug it into the wall in our house, we snip the other end off and run it into the inverter. It puts AC power in, we can use that power to charge our batteries and whatever. So if you're not planning on interacting with the grid necessarily, you can still put AC power directly from a generator or a house into an off-grid inverter. It doesn't mean it has no capability to do that. The other option, if you're not looking to go off-grid, would be something like a hybrid system where it can actually interact with the grid. It can read your battery percentages, it can read your solar input, it can read the input coming in from the grid, and it can kind of determine, okay, we're gonna charge your batteries with grid power because there's no sun available, or we're gonna charge batteries with solar and also power some devices with solar because we have so much excess solar available right now. It's smart enough to be able to make those decisions. You can also get inverters that have the ability to sell power back to the grid. If this is something that's still confusing to you, we actually have a full video breaking down all the different types of inverters that we will link in the description below. On a final note, as we mentioned earlier, maybe you don't want to install solar at all. In that case, you need to look at the AC input on your inverter. Maybe you're doing this to peak shave. An example of that would be you have an inverter with batteries and everything set up. You have no solar panels. During the night, when the power is off peak and it's at its cheapest, you use the inverter to charge those batteries. And then during the daytime, when the power is on peak and it's expensive, you actually power all of your devices in your house with the batteries to shave off that on-peak portion of your bill, saves you a little bit of money, and in that case, you might not want solar panels at all. If you don't, you just need to look at the AC input and make sure that during those nighttime hours or whatever the situation is that you're trying to do, that you have enough AC input to fully charge your battery bank during said time. And so the final step is to start shopping. Now you might realize really quickly that the system you need or want is outside of your budget, but know that it's okay to actually start small and expand later. However, if you're gonna try to cheap out, there is a right and a wrong place to do so. The wrong place would be your inverter. Your inverter needs to be big enough and have the proper output and input settings for your needs. If you go cheap on your inverter, you're gonna end up needing to sell it and buy a new one later, or you're gonna need to end up buying a second inverter and wiring them together to run parallel, doing a bunch of unnecessary work that could be avoided if you just buy the right inverter the first time. The right place to save some money would be on your batteries. You don't wanna cheap out on your batteries, but you don't have to buy all your batteries all at once. If you can't afford to do so, you can very easily buy half of the batteries that you need right now, set up your entire system, and then in the future, when you can afford it, you buy the other half of the batteries. Most batteries are expandable within their family, so if you go ahead and get a few server rack batteries now, and then you want to go ahead and expand later, it's as simple as sliding three more server rack batteries into that cabinet, plugging them in, and you're pretty much good to go. There's no real hassle or setup or anything needed additionally. Another place to save money that would be the right place would be on your solar array. Exactly the same as your battery bank. If you just buy half your solar array now, you set it all up. Solar panels can be wired in tons of different configurations depending on what your inverter requirements are. But you could very easily just buy the second half of your solar array, wire it all up, plug it in, and you're good to go. On the contrary, if you actually have the budget to do so, we always recommend purchasing a little bit of a bigger system than you actually need. Power needs tend to almost 100% increase with time. Maybe you have kids, they are using way more electronics than you thought they would. Maybe you buy an EV, maybe you just got a bigger fridge. Little things like that can make a huge difference in how much power you're actually consuming. So if you have the means to do so, buy a bigger kit than you think you're gonna need. If you're still looking for ways to save money, you can also do that by installing your system or parts of it or helping with parts of it yourself. A lot of it really isn't as complicated as you might think. You could start small by digging the trench from where you're gonna have your solar panels to where you're gonna route them into your house to help the installer save some time. You could go as big as building your own panel stands and getting them all mounted and just having someone come in and do the final connections on your inverters or whatever it is that you don't feel comfortable doing. And if you watch some YouTube videos on this stuff, you'll realize it's actually really, really simple. We also recommend buying from somewhere like Shop Solar or Signature Solar. They package everything into bundles and kits. So you're gonna be getting stuff that they already know all works together, and it's cheaper than buying everything individually. It ships all at once and you get everything that you're gonna need to make what you just bought work. They also have great support. You can easily call them. We've mystery shopped both of those companies and you can ask them for help. They'll help guide you through things. It's a lot easier than just trying to go out, spam the internet and buy a million components and put them together yourself. And our two cents is to never, ever, ever, ever lease your system. You're getting scammed. Finance it, do anything other than leasing the system. A bonus 2 cents that we have that might help you guys in the long run is if you're doing research, watching videos, which is good, that's what you should be doing. You should be learning as much as possible about things that you're spending your money on and how they work and how good they are. If you're doing research and watching a ton of videos, just be aware of lifestyle creators. There's nothing against lifestyle creators. I was one for a little under 10 years. The point is, people that maybe they have a homestead and that's what their channel's about, and then they get a solar setup from a company, they tend to be a lot more excited and generous towards the company and the brand because they actually just got something that changes their life. Like, their life is now dramatically different because of this product. So even if it's not the best or has problems, they might not be fully transparent about all those things because they're gassed. A lot of them also get paid to do so, and they get paid well. So they tend to say the better side of things. A channel like us here at the lab and a lot of other channels that stick to reviews, we actually spend money to get these products here, and it costs us money to store them. When you're doing your research, just make sure that you're getting your info more from people who do reviews and test multiple products, not from someone who just got one thing one time. You tend to only get the good side when you do that. So hopefully this helps you guys to some degree feel a little bit more comfortable moving forward. We have tons of discount codes that we have with multiple companies linked in the description down below to help you save money when the time comes to actually pull the trigger on a system. We have video reviews on tons of products. We have how-tos and kind of like an educational playlist that goes a little bit more into depth on all the points that we made today. That is all we got for you guys. Thank you so much for watching. Hopefully we were able to help some of you. We will catch you next time. Peace out and stay charged.